Would you please stand with me as you're able and read responsively the call to worship, and then remain standing for our first hymn, Easter People Raise Your Voices, found in the hymnal number 304. Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for his acts of power. Praise him for his surpassing greatness. Praise him with the sounding of the trumpet. Praise him with the harp and lyre. Praise him with timbrel and dancing. Praise him with the strings and pipe. Praise him with the clash of cymbals. Praise him with resounding cymbals. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Reading this morning comes from the book of John, chapter 20, verses 19 through 31. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and had said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and have yet come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. This is the good news. Praise to you, O Christ. Now please join us in singing Halle, Halle, Hallelujah.
Let's stand up for this one.
Halle, Halle, Halle.
To invite the children to come on up. I've got something I want to show you. You might want to get a little closer so you can see it. Let's see. There's Jeffrey. Oh, Ken's coming on up. Yay. Jeffrey and Kevin. Oh, Jeffrey, you're coming too. Great. All right. Just come on up, have a seat, and maybe look this way so you see what I'm holding. You can just sit right there if you want to. But you want to turn somehow this way so you can hear. Is that good? All right. So the first song we sang today was Easter People, Raise Your Voices. We say that we're an Easter people, right? Yeah. Because we believe in the resurrection of Jesus. And we're celebrating Easter for 50 days. We started last Sunday, and we're going to go all the way to the first Sunday in June. And that'll be Pentecost, and we'll talk about that more. So Easter people, that's what we're going to be hearing about in the stories that we hear from the Bible. Now, you already heard one story from the Bible. You heard the story of Thomas. Thomas was an Easter person, right? But Thomas, I've got a little something here for Thomas. Thomas wasn't so sure. He heard that Jesus was alive, but he said, I've got questions. I'm not sure I believe that. I'm not going to believe it until I see Jesus. And then, of course, the big surprise was that Jesus appeared to him too, and to many other people, not just Thomas. And this Easter person then believed in Jesus and the resurrection. And the next story you're going to hear from the Bible that Mrs. Rishti is going to read is the one I'm going to talk about a little bit more in the sermon, you know, when I get up there and I talk a little bit of a long time. Yeah. So anyway, we're going to hear about Peter. What do you think, what does Peter look like here? He looks surprised. That's right. He's got that surprise face, and I put an exclamation mark on his body to just show he's like, oh, whoa. And Peter really surprises us, because he started out after Jesus died and he was afraid and he was hiding and he was scared, and then he made a surprising turnaround. That means he changed and he wasn't afraid anymore. So we say that Peter is an Easter person who surprises us, okay? And God surprises us too. So those are the two Easter people I want to talk about this week. And next week, my plan is to have some of these folks and things that you can decorate to look like you, because you're Easter people too, right? We'll work on that over the season of Easter. If you don't have, okay, we'll work on that. Okay, let's pray. God, thank you for Jesus and the resurrection. Thank you that we are Easter people today, just like Thomas and just like Peter. Amen. All right. Thanks for coming up. Let's stand.
when the Spirit says sing. I'm gonna sing when the Spirit says sing and obey the Spirit of the Lord. I'm gonna pray when the Spirit says pray. I'm gonna pray when the Spirit says pray. I'm gonna pray when the Spirit says pray.
Be seated. This reading comes from the book of Acts, chapter 5, verses 27 through 32. When the captain and his guards had brought the apostles, they had them stand before the council. The high priest questioned them, saying, "We gave you strict orders not to teach in the name of Jesus. Yet here you are. You have filled Jerusalem with your teaching, and you have determined to bring this man's blood on us." But Peter and the apostles answered, "We must obey God rather than any human authority. The God of our ancestors raised up Jesus, whom you had killed by hanging him on a tree. God exalted him at his right hand as leader and savior, that he might give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. And we are witness to these things. And so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Will you pray with me? Lord, I ask that you'll take these broken words and use them to speak a word of hope and faith and courage to your people. In the name of Jesus Christ, the risen one, we pray. Amen. In these great 50 days of Easter, we'll be reading passages from the book of Acts. We'll be reading the gospel story too. We're going to focus on these stories from the book of Acts that record some surprising acts of God in the early church. All these surprises, of course, follow the grandest surprise of all, and that is that Jesus was resurrected from the dead after he was crucified. And I hope that in these stories that maybe we've heard many times or maybe we're hearing for the first time, that we'll begin to see ourselves and the new ways that God wants to act in our lives too. The stories of Jesus' first followers are remarkable, especially because we remember how they behaved after Jesus was arrested and tried and sentenced to die. Most of them just scattered. They ran in fear, leaving Jesus by himself to face all of this alone. Peter, the brash apostle who vowed to stay with Jesus no matter what, he did follow. He did follow Jesus to the high priest's house, but I'm sure he probably wasn't even allowed to go inside. He remained in the garden, right, trying to figure out what's going to happen. But when asked whether he was a follower of Jesus, well, we know that sad story. He vehemently denied it, not just once or twice, but three times. And we remember Thomas. You heard his story today for his unbelief after the resurrection. Sometimes Thomas gets all the, you know, what an unbeliever he was, you know. But he wasn't the only doubter among the disciples by any means. Peter himself had a history of unbelief in Jesus and what Jesus could do. At their first meeting, remember Jesus, after preaching a while, Jesus said, "Now put your boat out into the deep water and let your nets down again." And Peter doubted that it would do any good to go fishing again because he'd been trying all night and hadn't even caught a thing. Peter doubted that it would do any good when 5,000 people were hungry and needed something to eat. he said, you know, what can we do? Just send them home, Jesus, without even a morsel to tide them over, right? Peter doubted when Jesus walked across the Sea of Galilee. And he didn't in the beginning, remember. He went out there and joined him. And for a while, he was doing great. And then all of a sudden, he lost his courage. And he began to sink. Anyway, didn't go the way he wanted it to. But every time Peter doubted, Jesus came through in these unanticipated ways. The empty nets were filled with such an enormous catch, they almost broke the nets. The 5,000 sat down, and when Jesus blessed and broke 5 loaves and 2 fish, they all feasted until they were full, and there were leftovers. And Jesus saved Peter from drowning and carried him to the safety of the boat. And of course, the most astonishing surprise of all is that God raised Jesus from the dead. So God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit surprised Peter now, time and time again. But now we want to let ourselves be surprised by what happens to Peter. He and the other apostles aren't hiding out anymore. You can tell from just a little bit that Anne read. They are going loud, and they are going public with the story of Jesus. They're carrying on Jesus' work of healing, too. Just a little bit before today's text, they say that people would bring their loved ones on stretchers and lay them outside the temple, and when Peter walked by, his shadow, his mere shadow, would heal them. The post-resurrection work of Peter and the apostles catches the attention of the high priest and all of his associates. You see, they don't like it that the people are once again being influenced through the disciples by Jesus. The high priest is the spiritual leader of Israel, and no one should be usurping his authority. He thinks, especially not this ragtag bunch of Jesus followers. The high priest arrests Peter and the apostles and put them in jail overnight. Perhaps he thinks, well, that'll show them. That'll spark a little fear in their hearts when they remember what happened to Jesus. Maybe enough fear to keep them from their mission. However, God has other plans. And during the night, an angel comes and releases them from jail with the directions, really simple directions, get back to the temple and keep on teaching. And so the apostles don't waste a minute. When it's daylight, they're back in the temple teaching. And the high priest and his guys, though, they're none the wiser. So the council gathers and he sends for Peter and the others, but they are not in their jail cell. The captain of the guard can't even figure out how they've gotten out because the doors are still locked. And all of the guards are standing at their stations. So he goes back, and I'm sure he doesn't like to do it, but he reports this to the chief priest. And while they're all trying to figure out, well, now what are we supposed to do? Someone shows up and says, those men you arrested, they're back in the temple. They're doing exactly what you told them not to do. So the guards go to arrest them again, but this time they sense that the sentiment of the crowd is with the apostles, and so they treat them with respect. They don't rough them up or anything. They just gently take them back to the high priest's house. And when the apostles arrive there, the high priest says, well, you know, we know what you're doing. You're trying to lay the blame for this man's death on us. And Peter, now to be honest, does lay some of the blame at their feet, saying, you know, you had him killed by hanging him on a tree. And that was a particularly awful way to die. In the Hebrew scriptures, that was the symbol that somebody was accursed. But we have to be careful here, I've said this kind of thing before, and I'm going to say it again. Passages like this have fueled some pretty virulent anti-Semitism for 2,000 years. And I don't think Peter ever intended Christ followers to hate Jews. Jesus was a Jew. Peter and all the apostles at this point were Jews. Peter never intended Jews to be running from country to country, trying to find a safe place to live, never thought that they should be annihilated or harassed in their synagogues with bomb threats. That's a gross misreading of the scripture. First, it was the religious leaders who were in cahoots with the Roman officials. Not everybody. Not everybody was involved in that, in the condemnation of Christ. And we know religious leaders of all stripes can get too involved with political leaders and do things that they might ought not to do. So the Jews aren't special on that. So there's that. And then second, while Peter does not absolve the religious leaders of their part in Jesus' death, it really seems like the last thing he wants is revenge. Do you hear any words of revenge there? He doesn't say, "Oh, all of you deserve to die for what you did." No. Peter says, "God exalted Jesus as Lord and Savior so that he might give repentance and forgiveness of sins to Israel." As for stopping the teaching about Jesus, well, Peter's very clear that he has to answer to a higher power than to the high priest or the council or the Sadducees or the Pharisees. What a surprising turnaround. You know, for me, this has always been one of the greatest proofs of the resurrection, something that obviously can't be fully proven, although some people might argue me with that. But it's a great proof that Peter and the other disciples, fearful and seemingly lost, just lost after Jesus' death, experienced nothing less than a miraculous change of heart and mind and action. Peter goes from fear and unbelief to a fearless faith. And because of all of his experiences with Jesus, those that I talked about earlier, and most especially his experience in the resurrection, Peter truly believes that no matter how grim or hopeless things seem, God is always up to something new. Now, Peter is by no means without his flaws. And it's not that he'll never let his fears influence him again. You know, Peter's a lot like us. Right. In a few weeks, I'll talk about Peter taking a bold stance for fully including Gentiles in the church. But you know, someday in the future after that, he's going to waffle a little bit about his treatment of the Gentiles, enough for his fellow apostle Paul to call him out and say, "Now you know that's not right. You know that's not right. You're not fully living into the vision that you had." So Peter's not perfect, but we can learn from Peter when it comes to our faith, living our faith. Because what if instead of letting our fears dominate us, and you know, he had some reason to be afraid. He got arrested. He's going to get flogged for, you know, refusing to stop preaching. He had some reason to be fearful. But what if we, instead of letting our fears dominate, we remembered that all that God has done in our lives through Christ. Sometimes we focus too much on failures and fears, but God calls us to a new way of life in the Spirit, right? The new way rejects fear and embraces a courageous kind of faith. You know, fear says, "I'll never be able to pay my bills or do what I want to do if I share a portion of what I have." But faith says, you know, "I'll joyfully give some of what I earn and what I possess to help in the building of God's kingdom." And there are a lot of ways that people are building God's kingdom in the world. You just have to see where God's calling you, right? Fear says, "I'm afraid of what people will think of me if I, maybe they'll reject me if I talk about my faith." Because, you know, we don't like to do that so much in America sometimes. But faith says, you know, I can share with sincerity what my faith means to me and leave the consequences in God's hands. Fear says, you know, I want to know more about my faith. I feel like I'm just kind of on the edges. I want to know more. And sometimes I think I'd like to join a group that's doing some deeper study, but I'm afraid. I'm afraid of looking just a little bit ignorant because of all the things I don't understand. Let me say to you all, if you're that person, welcome to the club. You know, I'm a member of that club too. So much I still don't understand. So much to learn. But faith says the Holy Spirit can work with me right where I am and begin building that in my heart. And I can ask the questions that plague me, that I'm afraid to ask because I think other people all know the answer. I can ask those questions and not be afraid of what others think. Fear says, if I take a stand on issues of justice with my friends or my family or at work, it might threaten my security in those circles. If I speak out about harmful cultural biases or economic or health care disparities, I might lose my friends, right? Or maybe even my career. But faith says, I've got to listen to the Spirit and I've got to speak where the Spirit leads me and when the Spirit leads me. Fear says I might fail, so I'd rather not use my God-given talents for the kingdom. I might mess it up. Faith says, by God's grace, I am enough. You are enough. And God can use you and me for good work in this world. Fear says, I have to hide who I really am. I have to put on this mask, or people won't accept me. Now, I know we all wear masks, right? But sometimes faith says, you know, take off that mask. I'm willing to be vulnerable, to admit my flaws and my foibles so others can feel safe sharing their fears and their challenges with me. You know, fear, even unacknowledged fear, and I am convinced that we all have a lot of that, even unacknowledged fear can hold us in its grip. So I wonder if this morning you can recall a fear that has held you back in your discipleship. Just take a minute to think about that. A fear that has held you back in discipleship. I invite you just to offer that fear to God. Say, here, God, do what you can with it, right? Now try to remember a time when you acted in faith and God surprised you. A time you acted in faith and God surprised you. I was sharing with the women in the Bible study on Thursday that has seemed to happen over and over in this church for me. Yeah. And you know what? If you can't think of a time when your faith, God working through your faith surprised you, that is okay. Just pray. Pray for the time when that's going to become real in your life, right? Pray, God, I'm willing to be surprised. Help me step out in faith. And so trusting in our past experiences and in hope for new experiences, right? I wonder if we can just open ourselves up a little more to the power of God working in us trusting that God has some new things to show us. God's not done. New things for us to do in his name. God's not done with surprises. And I think God is just waiting on us to trust God's grace more. And you know, although all of us may want that Peter experience, that wow encounter, right? That leaves no room for unbelief or fear. And you may get that. I'm not saying you're not, right? You may have had it even. But it's just as likely that our faith will grow in 1,000 little ways every time we take the risk to make the faithful choice to do the courageous thing. For it's in these faithful choices that God will show up and honor those choices and surprise us. Surprise us. And so what I want to leave you with today, and maybe something to ponder this week, is what courageous thing is God calling you to do, right? Think about how you're going to obey that call. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Today, O God, we are reminded by your holy word of what people of faith are like. In case we've forgotten, we're reminded of their joy and their trust in you. We're reminded of how your presence in their lives conquers their doubts and their fears. O Lord, work strongly in us and conform our lives to the example of Jesus and of all those with a living faith. And help us to walk in your glorious light and rejoice in your saving truth as the Easter people that we are. Gracious God, we recall how the sadness of the disciples was turned to joy and how their fear was turned to courage by your risen presence. Help us to show your present reality to all those around us who dwell in fear and sadness. Help us, the people of Christ everywhere, to bring comfort to those who grieve and strength to those who are ill and blessings to all those in need. Lord, hear our prayer, too, for those in special need of your presence this day. We ask that your Spirit may touch those we name before you in the silence of our hearts. That your Son might visit them and speak a word of healing. That your nameless servants in this world might bring to them your comfort and your grace. We especially remember today Jean Provo, Elizabeth, Fran Fleming, Bill, the Hiltz family, the Conger family, the Hubbard family, Susan, Linda, Josh, Mofu in medical training in Russia, the people of Ukraine and Russia, and the people of Sri Lanka. And O Lord, if there are people we love anywhere in this world, well, we know there are people that you love everywhere in this world. And we pray for all who are experiencing unrest or war or sickness or famine. We thank you, O God, for your power and presence in our lives. We thank you for those among us who are celebrating birthdays this week. We'll pray for Wendy and Tom and those celebrating anniversaries, for Patricia and Patrick, for Sandy and Vansel, and pray the joy of your love and the peace that comes from you upon their homes. Make us known as a people who share the power and presence that you give to us, so that the glory we intend to give unto you may be given by all, and so that our joy may be complete in Christ Jesus our Lord, who taught us to pray as one, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now, beloved, if you'd like to stand right where you are and turn to the people who are around you and wave or give them a sign of peace, or just let them know that you are glad they are here. Amen and amen. All right, you may be seated. It is such a joy, again, to see all of you. And I want to thank you for the ways that you support this church. I was talking to somebody the other day about church membership, and she said, what does that mean? And I said, well, it means you vow to be a part of the church by your prayers, your presence here or online, your gifts, your service, and your witness, telling what Christ has done for you. So thank you for taking those vows and for living into those vows and for being here this day. So now I invite you to continue in worship as we receive this offertory. And before we do, just to remind you that you can put your offering in the boxes that are out on the table in the narthex. They're two wooden boxes. You can give by Vanco. You can give through your bank. There are lots of ways. You can mail a check. We're an equal opportunity, you know, in that regard. So God bless you all for all that you have done already and for what you will do. Amen.
remain standing for the prayer of thanksgiving, followed by the hymn Trust and Obey in your hymnal, number 467. God of power and majesty, with the rising of the sun, you raised Jesus Christ and delivered him and us from death's destruction. We praise you on this bright day for all of your gifts of new life. Especially, we thank you for loyalty and love of friends and family. We thank you for the newborn, the newly baptized, and those now in your eternal home. We thank you for the renewal of nature. By your Holy Spirit, make your church one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Beloved, I believe we have coffee out in the narthex and some goodies, so I invite you to grab a goodie and visit in the narthex or step out into this beautiful day and enjoy each other's company. So receive this blessing before you go. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and in our Savior, Jesus Christ. And may God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit remain with you always. Amen.
Amen.